Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org with 6 things you should know when you use Hibernate with a PostgreSQL database. PostgreSQL is one of the most popular relational databases, and Hibernate is probably the most popular JPA implementation. So it's no surprise that they are often used together and that you don't have to expect any major issues doing that. But as so often, there's a difference between it works and it works great. Out of the box, Hibernate and PostgreSQL work well together. But if you want to use both systems to their fullest extent, you need to know a few things and avoid some others. Here's my list of the 6 most important things you should know when you want to use Hibernate with PostgreSQL. First, generate primary keys. Primary keys and the generation of unique values seems to be basic features. The JPA specification defines different strategies to generate primary key values, and you can use all of them with PostgreSQL. But that doesn't mean that you should just pick any one of them. The table strategy uses a database table to generate unique primary key values. This requires pessimistic locking and isn't the most efficient approach. The identity strategy forces Hibernate to execute the SQL insert statement immediately. Due to this, Hibernate can't use any of its performance optimization strategies that require a delayed execution of the statement. One example of that is JDBC batching. But it can also affect simple things like updating an attribute before the entity gets persisted. When Hibernate has to execute the insert statement immediately, it has to perform an additional update statement to persist the changed value instead of using that value in the insert statement. The best generation strategy you can use with a PostgreSQL database is the sequence strategy. It uses a simple database sequence and is highly optimized by PostgreSQL. And Hibernate uses an optimized algorithm by default to avoid unnecessary statements. Let's take a quick look at an example that uses a custom database sequence. Here you can see the required annotations to use a custom database sequence. I know, it looks like a lot, but don't worry. It's not as complicated as it might look. The ID annotation tells Hibernate that this is a primary key attribute. The generated value annotation tells Hibernate to generate a unique value using a database sequence and to look at the book generator for more details on how to do that. The generator gets defined by this annotation. It tells Hibernate to request a new value from the sequence book sequence. Okay, that's all you need to do. Let's talk about the second thing you need to know about using Hibernate with a PostgreSQL database. 2. Use custom data types. PostgreSQL supports a set of proprietary data types which Hibernate doesn't map by default. Popular examples for that are the JSON and JSONB data types, which allow you to persist and query JSON documents in a PostgreSQL database. If you want to use these types with Hibernate, you need to define the mapping yourself. That requires additional code, but it's not as complicated as it might sound. You just need to implement and register a user type which tells Hibernate how to map the Java object to a supported JDBC type, and vice versa. I explained the required implementation in great detail on my blog. You can find a link to it in the video description. You can use the same approach to implement a custom mapping for all PostgreSQL types that are not supported by Hibernate. 3. Map read-only views. From a mapping point of view, database tables and views are pretty similar and you can map both of them to an entity class. The only difference is that some views are read-only, and it's a good practice to map them to a read-only entity. By default, Hibernate supports read and write operations for all entities. If you want to make an entity read-only, you have to tell Hibernate that it is immutable. You can do that by annotating the entity class with an immutable annotation. Here you can see the BookView entity, which maps the view BookView. I annotated it with entity and immutable. That makes it a read-only entity which you can use in queries and to define relationships. This test case, for example, uses the BookView entity in a simple JPQL query and writes a log message for each entity. As you can see in the log output, Hibernate performed a simple SQL query to select all records from the view BookView. And the following lines show a log message for each selected entity. I annotated the BookView entity with immutable and Hibernate will therefore ignore all update operations on it. Here you can see a simple test case that tries to change the title of a BookView entity with ID 1. Let's run this test and see how Hibernate handles it. Here you can see the select statement that Hibernate used to get the BookView entity with ID 1. This is the only database interaction Hibernate performed. It ignored the change title attribute and didn't execute an SQL update statement for it. 4. Use PostgreSQL specific query features. When you're familiar with JPQL and SQL, you already know that JPQL supports only a small subset of the SQL standard. But that's not a real issue. Because if JPQL isn't powerful enough to implement your use case, you can use a native SQL query instead. Native SQL queries allow you to use the full SQL feature set, including all database-specific features. You can create them in a similar way as your JPQL queries. You can define a named native query with a named native query annotation, or create an ad hoc native query by calling the create native query method on the entity manager. Let's take a quick look at an example. Here you can see a named native query annotation. As you can see, it looks very similar to a named query annotation. The main difference is that you need to provide a native SQL instead of a JPQL statement as the query. As I said earlier, that allows you to use all query features that are supported by your database. A named native query can be used in the same way as a named query. You just need to call the create named query method of the entity manager with the name of your named native query. You then get a query instance that you can use to set bind parameter values, to define pagination, and to execute the query. That's all about native queries for now. If you'd like to learn more about it, please take a look at my native query video. I will add a link to it to the video description. 5. Call PostgreSQL specific functions. You can, of course, use a native SQL query to call a PostgreSQL specific SQL function in the same way as you use any other proprietary query feature. But since JPA 2.1, you can also call these functions in your JPQL queries. The JPQL function allows you to call any SQL functions supported by your database. You just need to provide the name of the function as the first parameter, followed by an optional list of parameters that will be used to call the SQL function. Here you can see a simple example that calls the SQL function calculate with the parameters 1 and 2. This is a custom database function that calculates the sum of the two parameters. So when I execute this test case, Hibernate will perform this query and PostgreSQL will call the function to calculate the sum of the parameters. It will then return the book that has an ID equal to the calculation result. Here you can see the query, and as expected,
It called the calculate function and returned the book with ID 3.
6. Calls.procedures. PostgreSQL doesn't distinguish between functions and stored procedures. It only supports very flexible functions, which can be used like stored procedures or as SQL functions. I already showed you how to call a non-standard SQL function, so let's take a look at the stored procedures. When your PostgreSQL function returns a ref cursor parameter, which is a cursor on a result set, you need to call it like a stored procedure. Since JPA 2.1, you can do that with a named stored procedure query or an ad hoc stored procedure query. Here you can see the example of a named stored procedure query. It defines the call of the getReviews stored procedure. It tells Hibernate to provide an input parameter of type long and to expect a ref cursor as a result. The result class parameter tells Hibernate to map all records of the ref cursor to review objects. You can call the name.procedure query in a similar way as you would call a named query. You just need to call the createNames.procedure query method to instantiate the query, set the input parameters, and retrieve the result.
Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about the Java 8 support in Hibernate 5. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you like today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!